Telusk Forum. Today, Suzanne will be talking to Molly about a decision that she's made in order to raise funds to support children suffering from cancer. Then Jim Stewart from Open Doors tells us about their work and how we can support it. Helen, our poet, explains how she goes about writing poetry and reads us one of her latest compositions. Then Dr. Carl talks to Julian about the benefits of giving and sharing for our mental well-being. And finally, the large family brings us a new song. During the programme, do look out for photographs of Helen and Anthony Seys Llewellyn's lovely garden on the Fuddug. For the time being, our programme will continue to go out fortnightly. As we enter the autumn, we would welcome your comments on the Telusk programmes so that we can improve the contents and encourage new participants and hopefully grow our audience.
Hello, my name is Suzanne and I'm delighted to be chatting to Molly today about an amazing choice that she's made. I think I've known you for probably about 2 years now. Ever since you joined the Youth Alpha group, which met at our house. We met once a week, so I gradually got to know you quite well. We enjoyed some good food, we had a lot of laughter, a lot of banter. We watched a video about life and God and how God wants to have a relationship with us all. And then we had some pretty interesting discussions with all our varied viewpoints, so that was great. Anyway, enough about that. We've come here to talk about you today, not about that. And what you're planning to do on August the 25th, which is next Tuesday.
Mm-hmm. Ta-da!
It's a week today. Could you just tell us a bit about yourself and how it's got to this point?
As Suzanne said, I'm Molly. I just turned 16 and I'm currently waiting for GCSE results. Hoping to start A-levels in September. I'm originally from Australia, and then throughout my entire life I've moved around the place, travelled around the place. I've lived in Australia, China, and well, now Wales. Had loads and loads of different experiences everywhere I've been. Travelled all around the world, Africa, Asia, Europe. So I've been a lot of places and I've seen a lot of things in my life.
So what's led up to you wanting to do what you're going to do? Perhaps you should tell us now what it is you're going to do next Tuesday.
Next Tuesday, August 25th, I'm going to be cutting all of this off and shaving my head. The money then that I raise is going to the Children with Cancer UK. And what's led up to this really is, since a very young age, I've always wanted to do medicine as a career, whether that be veterinary or a doctor or anything like that. And now, obviously, I guess I have to make my mind up, and I'm set on being a pediatric oncologist, so a children's cancer doctor. And after seeing so many things in traveling around the world, living all around, it's something that so many thousands of people, kids and families, are affected by. So if I can do a small thing and just help all those people, well, why wouldn't I?
It's amazing. So how long is your hair today?
My hair currently is around 18 inches long.
Wow, so that's long.
Very long.
And what's actually going to happen to this hair once it comes off? It's not going in the bin, is it? What's going to happen to this hair?
So I'll cut my ponytail, which my ponytail will then be donated to Little Princesses Trust, and then shaving my head, which I've got a Just Giving page, which I'm raising money for, and then that money goes straight to the Children with Cancer UK.
That's fabulous. Could you tell us a little bit more about the Little Princesses Trust? Because I guess not everybody knows what that is.
Yeah, so Little Princesses Trust, you can donate money, you can donate hair, and they basically make wigs for children with cancer and just make them feel happy and confident again with their hair that they may have lost through chemotherapy.
Yeah, and actually it's absolutely amazing thing, because surprisingly I know a little bit about that, having been out to Belarus. the fallout from Chernobyl all went on to Belarus, and the children there, there's so many cases of childhood leukemia and different kinds of cancers, and I was privileged to visit two different oncology units. The first one I'd really geared up for, thinking, how am I going to feel with what it's going to be like? And when I got in there, I was amazed because all the kids had hair. Some of them had plaits, some of them had ponytails. I couldn't figure how this was, and it was because people have been generous like you and actually donated hair, and all of those children were wearing wigs. Later in the trip, I went to an oncology ward where none of them had their hair at all, and the atmosphere was entirely different. It was very somber. The children didn't feel at ease with other children who didn't look like they usually look. So you're doing something absolutely amazing.
Thank you.
Yeah. So you want to raise some money for cancer, Children Cancer UK. Mm-hmm. How much are you hoping to raise?
Well, currently my target is set at £1,000.
Fantastic.
So whatever I can, I'll be amazed by.
And what are you up to at the moment?
I'm just over £400 now.
That's fantastic. And on your Facebook page, I notice it says looks for books. Can you unpack a bit what that's about for us?
Yeah, so the looks of books basically means changing my looks, cutting and shaving my head, for books, which is about knowledge and about research, and books being, well, yeah, research for childhood cancers and everything into that, and making treatment as good and not necessarily easy, but just better than what it is now for all the children, thousands of children with cancer every year in the UK.
I think what you're doing is fantastic. I mean, if people would like to support you in any way, what would they need to do?
Well, you can, as I said, I've got my Just Giving page. So you can go onto justgiving.com and you can search for looks for books, and it should come up with my name, Molly Kiernan. You can also go to justgiving.com/mollyk.774, which takes you to the exact same page.
Well, thank you very much, Molly. And maybe perhaps in a future program we could have a before and after picture.
Of course,
yeah. That would be really great. So if you can, and if you've been touched by this, and most of us do know someone who's struggled with cancer in one form or another, if you'd like to donate, please do, because I think what Molly's doing is really generous and actually pretty brave.
Hi, I'm Jim and I work for Open Doors. Open Doors is an international Christian organization founded in 1955 that supports and serves persecuted Christians and churches in over 60 countries around the world. We supply Bibles, train church leaders, provide practical support and emergency relief, and support Christians who are suffering for their faith. What is persecution, you may ask? Christian persecution is any hostility experienced as a result of one's identification as a Christian. It can come from government, communities, or families. And examples of it are Christians being killed, abducted, detained without trial, Christian women being raped or forced into marriage, and churches being attacked. Today, over 260 million of our brothers and sisters around the world, living in countries where it is often dangerous to be a Christian, are facing high or extreme levels of persecution. That is, one out of every eight of the global Christian population. Let me tell you the story of Leah Sharibu. 2.5 years ago, in February 2018, Leah, then a 14-year-old Christian girl, was kidnapped along with over 100 other girls from their school in northeast Nigeria by the Islamist terrorist group Boko Haram. The following month, the kidnappers released all of the girls except Leah. Leah, the only Christian girl in the group, had been told that a condition of her release was for her to make the Muslim declaration of faith and convert to Islam. However, as a devout Christian, she refused to do so. Her Muslim friends in the group even begged her to simply pretend to accept Islam, but Leah could not even do that. A truck arrived to take the kidnapped girls back to their families, but the kidnappers told Leah again that if she didn't convert to Islam, she would not be released, and would remain with them. She refused. The other girls boarded the truck, waved to Leah and cried as it sped away, and Leah was left alone with her kidnappers. That was 2.5 years ago, and Leah is still alive but remains in captivity. She is one of millions of Christian females around the world who are suffering because of their faith and gender. One of our current focuses is on Christians who are being discriminated against in the provision of government aid during the COVID-19 pandemic. Many, from Vietnam to India to Nigeria, are the last in line when aid is being handed out. Here, Akash, one of our partners in India, says, "We see people in great need. We have to help them, even if it is risky." And a Christian leader in Bangladesh says, "Some of the believers are starving. Some are forced to eat less so that they can maximize the number of days they can continue to have food. Some are borrowing money with high interest rates to buy food. None of them have received any kind of support or relief aid from the government yet." Open Doors began in 1955 through the work of an amazing young Dutch Christian who became known as Brother Andrew. His life work began almost by accident when, as an 18-year-old, he went to Poland to attend a communist youth conference. During the visit, he met for the first time committed Christians from the communist countries of Central and Eastern Europe. These were believers who felt isolated and who did not have access to Bibles, but who were so encouraged by Brother Andrew's interest in them. From this experience, God spoke to Brother Andrew through a verse in the book of Revelation to strengthen that which remains and was about to die. This became his life calling and thus began a remarkable ministry in which Brother Andrew made countless trips to countries behind the Iron Curtain to take in Bibles and to encourage the church. His story is told in the much-loved book, God Smuggler. Perhaps some of you have heard of it or read it even. From there, Open Doors grew, always maintaining its focus on serving persecuted Christians, but now working in over 60 countries where it is most dangerous to be a Christian. Our vision is to be a strong church, defying persecution, standing together, and sharing our faith in Jesus, no matter what the cost. I work for Open Doors as Church Relations Manager for Wales. I started in January, shortly before the lockdown. And it's the first time that Open Doors has had a dedicated staff role for Wales, although for many years, there's been a team of volunteers that have spoken in churches and helped out in other ways. You may be wondering about my accent. I was born in Newport, but I grew up in Canada. My dad is from Chepstow, and his father, my grandfather, was from just up the road from you in Herefordshire by Longtown. So we lived in Canada until I was 14, and then we came back to Caldecott. I did my O-levels, A-levels. Then I went back to Canada just after I turned 20, and it was at that point that I became a committed Christian. What drives me in my work with Open Doors is being able to do something to support my brothers and sisters around the world who, for no fault of their own, are suffering for their faith. I find it incredibly rewarding and a blessing, even if some days all I can do is pray. I'm married to Natmi, who herself is a refugee, having fled persecution from Eritrea in East Africa. As she came here 10 years ago, and but a year after she arrived here, we were married. She's done really well, and this month she was confirmed in rank with South Wales Police as a police constable. So you might see her out and about in the streets in Cardiff. So we've been married 9 years, and we have a 7-year-old boy, Caleb, who is full of life. You can sign up to receive our regular emails to get stories and hear how you can make an impact for persecuted Christians. Go to opendoorsuk.org and scroll down to subscribe under the prayer and praise section. Or if you'd like to use our prayer resources, go to opendoorsuk.org/resources/prayer. If you scroll down to the bottom on the right, you'll see prayer diary and a link to click. This is a resource that I use every day that enables me to pray in an informed way. You can pray for me, for God to help me grow into my role with Open Doors, connecting Christians and churches in Wales to the persecuted church around the world. And for Open Doors, that God would protect our partners around the world from COVID-19 and give them strength as they bring emergency aid to Christians in need. I'll bring this to a close by showing a short but incredibly inspiring video of Pastor Marcus from Northern Nigeria.
Sananina yazama taki na bishara. Wanda yana karban mutane 200 bayan da Boko Haram suka tafi yanzu akwai mutane sun kai 300-400 suna nan week kowane lokaci amma da haka din abun karfafawa ne saboda haka wannan ma ba za mu yi addu'a cewa ba ubangiji Allah ya dauke sanani ba a'a sai dai mu yi addu'a cewa ubangiji Allah ya ba mu karfafawa wanda za mu jimre domin kitab mai tsarki yace wanda ya jimre har matufa zai samu menene zai samu tsira kitab mai tsarki shine sako da muke so aika ma duniya a ranar yau kada mu ji tsoro kada mu firgita a sai bege tana zuwa mana saboda ka hanyar nan Yesu Almasihu ya bi saboda ka tunda mu almajirai nasa na gaskiya mu ma sai mun dandana amma karshe zamu samu nasara.
Home of Helen, our poet in residence. We've been hearing Helen's poems on the Telusk forum on alternate weeks, and I'm going to speak to Helen about writing her poems. Helen, the first time I read your poems were in the magazine, the Ministry Area magazine, and I was taken with your poems and wondered how you could write month after month after month. So how long have you been writing poems?
Well, thank you, Alison. I started to write them seriously, as it were, when we moved back to Wales.
Yes.
12 years ago now.
Right.
And I just so love the countryside here, where I grew up.
Yes.
I've had a real reconnection with it.
Right.
It's a bit of creations come out of it in a little way. That's what I like.
Oh, that's good. So this... Well, it is very inspiring around here.
Yes.
And your garden is very inspiring
too. Thank you very much.
So, your motivation, what forms the motivation when you're going to begin a new poem?
I do get my inspiration from nature usually, but then you have to have a little idea as well. I can't just sit down and write a poem today.
Right.
You know, something I have to spark it, and it just depends.
Mm-hmm.
It might be some idea that I've had in my head for a few weeks, or it might be... Well, I must do that, but I can't just sit down and write when I have to germinate it.
Yes. Because you've had a range of subjects. It could be a person,
mm-hmm.
it could be a landscape,
yes.
It could be a season,
it could.
Or a celebration.
Yes.
Yes, mm-hmm. So you've covered a whole lot of topics.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
So this seems to flow from you once you get your motivation. How would you encourage anyone else to put pen to paper?
We've all got something in us, the creative spark, whether it's knitting, writing, drawing, something like that. And I would encourage everyone to just try and write your thoughts down and see what it looks like and read them back to yourself.
Mm-hmm.
Because I do think out loud is best, always with poems.
Right.
Read a lot of other poets.
Yes.
See what you like.
Yes.
And that's what I think is the best thing to do.
Yes.
And don't worry about it. Just have a go, really. You know.
So have you had any training?
Not really, no. I did subscribe to the Writers' Forum for a year or two.
Yes.
That was interesting to read other people's work.
Yes.
And I had one poem in that.
Uh-huh.
That I thought, there's one published.
Yes.
And another one I sent in, which I liked. They didn't like it at all. So it's all subjective, isn't
yes,
it?
Yes, it is very much, yes.
So, you know, it's what you like.
Yes.
But
yes.
Ross Marsh has been very encouraging, and mm-hmm. I've been doing them for her. But please, can other people do the same? That would be wonderful. That's it, Ross.
So this is an appeal for other people to...
Yes, please.
...to write poetry,
absolutely.
So you're not the only one doing it.
I think so. Right.
Well, we've very much enjoyed your poems and
you
reading to us through... these last weeks and months of lockdown.
Thank you very much. Yeah, enjoyed it.
Good. Well, may you continue to get inspired and write more.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
You're welcome. This poem is called Walking the Ways, and in it I'm trying to suggest that we need to keep the paths open so that future generations will always have the footpaths to walk on, as they had in the past. Walk the ways, past docks and nettles, crazy grasses after rain. Walk the ways over stiles, through mud and puddles. Keep the pulse, the ribbon threaded, as you breathe the blue sky in. Listen to the seeds popping in the heat, to insects in the hawthorn hedge, dense with summer. Hear the distant grind of tractors, the high kites mewing on the wind. On up to the common, woven with yellow rattle, marsh orchid, sweet water mint, and in the middle a cool stream for the dog to take a drink. Treading on memories, on paths where girls danced and laughed, hair crowned with sticky bud, necks with daisies wound round and round, far too warm in hobnailed boots, a giddy time the summer, then as now. On up to Tom's field, in time to see the foal's first breath, its mother's soft nose caress, pure loveliness. Walk the ways, keep the timeless lines for those to come, yet to find the place to call their own, to plant their feet, to sing their song.
Hi, Carl.
Hi, Julian.
Do you want to just recap a little bit on what we've already looked at before we dive in today onto the topic you've got?
We've looked at the importance of relationships and how we need to look at our friends and our families and build our contacts and our time with them. We've looked at the physical and emotional benefits of exercise, that it gives you energy, it gives you a sense of well-being to be out and about and doing things actively, but it also helps you feel good in yourself. And then the last time we looked at learning and how if we stretch ourselves and we learn new things or we revisit our skills that we've had in the past, how that gives us a sense of achievement and the feeling of a warm glow when we've actually, you know, put into practice something which is new to us and has stretched us. And so today I wanted to look at a sort of related area, but it is a little bit different, and that's the area of giving or sharing, and how just doing those things can really help us keep ourselves well in difficult times.
What sort of giving are we talking about?
Well, obviously, the Bible says, and it's general wisdom, Paul says that God loves a cheerful giver. So if our giving is dragged out of us reluctantly or grudgingly, that isn't really going to help us. We'll end up feeling angry or resentful rather than feeling better. But the sort of giving that I'm talking about is the sort of free giving, the generous, open, a friendly, not counting the cost type of giving, which gives a reward both to the person who receives the gift but also to the person who gives the gift. I think we all know the difference between giving which is done freely and generously from giving which is done grudgingly and of necessity. And it's the free, generous, enjoyable giving that I'm talking about, really.
How would you advise those who are actually feeling the pinch at the moment to be giving? It seems like an appropriate thing to be doing just at the moment.
Well, of course, it's not just about giving money, and it's certainly not about giving large amounts of money. Jesus himself commended the widow who gave just a mite into the collection. You know, we're not encouraging people to give large donations here or there and everywhere. But I'm talking more about giving not only our money, but also our time and sharing ourselves with others. When we give and when we share, we take our attention off ourselves. And anxiety and depression, they're very self-obsessed. when you're feeling low and you're anxious, you're very concerned about your feelings, your needs, what's happening to you. And the act of giving and sharing takes your attention off yourself and directs it onto someone else. And that in and of itself is a really beneficial thing. Being self-obsessed is not a good, healthy place to be. And lifting your eyes and looking outwards is a break. It's a relief from doing that. And of course, the other thing, the second thing about it is that we not only do we take our attention off ourselves, but we put our attention onto somebody else who has a need. And when we do that, we open ourselves up to something inside us, which is really beautiful. Our compassion and our generosity and our kindness and our willingness, our sympathy to step into someone else's shoes. And as we open ourselves up to those things inside us and they flow out of us to another person in giving, we sort of get benefited on the way. So, it's good to think that as we are giving and sharing and caring for other people, beautiful things from within us are flowing out of us and they're blessing us on that journey. And then thirdly, of course, sharing things builds our relationships. And then also, maybe we do that with another group if we volunteer or we join a group to help people. Not only are we helping people, but we're sharing in that helping experience with others. And so that sort of builds our relationships. And then, of course, we're also being physically active, maybe we're learning new skills in the process. So you can see how giving and sharing also feeds those other areas of resilience that we talked about in final weeks. And then the last thing I think that giving and sharing does is it tends to bring pleasure and delight to another person. And in their thankfulness and their gratitude, we also have a reflected blessing. We all know how nice it feels when we've made a real effort to give someone a present and that person loves the gift that we've given. How good that makes us feel. And so I think, that when we give, there's always the chance that will be, some of it will be reflected back on us. That's not why we do it, but that's always a possibility. And I would say here that I think that this is where we can all learn to express thanks and gratitude freely. I know that while we went down to Newquay and we were walking along the coastal path, and we made an effort to socially distance. We turned into the hedgerows or we moved to one side. And there was an enormous difference to how we felt about that when people said thank you for that simple act. And it made us feel really good and strengthened us for times when perhaps people didn't say thank you. So I think we live in days of entitlement where people feel they're owed things and they deserve things. And perhaps we've forgotten the simple grace of gratitude and expressing our thankfulness more. And I think that part of giving and sharing is also that expression of gratitude.
Have you got any thoughts on how we should prioritise our giving and our sharing, given the number of people around that seem to be in need at the moment?
I would say give and get involved more. So if you're giving gifts to charities, get a bit more involved in the work of those charities. And maybe volunteer or just read about them so that your giving is a much richer experience for you. You understand what you're giving into much better. Make phone calls. We can write letters and send cards. Those are often really appreciated. We can do garden visits or arrange a bit of time with people. Sharing our time is really important. And that's something which, people really appreciate. I think just to be aware of opportunities when you're chatting to people, when you're out and about, listen out for those who are lonely, those who've had something bad happen to them, those that are, you know, possibly having a particularly hard time. And then think about how you could share something with them, whether it's, you know, ringing them up, writing them a card, baking them a cake or some biscuits, just knocking on their door and saying, I've left something for you. My parents at the moment are giving me blackberries. You know, they pick blackberries on their walks. And so I'm with those, I'm able to make jam. And so I'm able to give that to my family members and so on. And so you use what resources you have, whether it's cooking, whether it's IT skills, whether it's, you know, sort of any crafting that you do, knitting and those things. Just sharing your loaves and fishes. You know, the Bible says that it's far more blessed to give than it is to receive. Both are blessed, but it's far better to give than it is to receive. And the book of Proverbs says that, you know, there is a sense in which you can scatter things, but you can be richer for doing it. And if you water others, you yourself will be watered. And I think that's a general rule in life. And I'm sure that if, you know, if you want to lift yourself up, then giving is a definite thing that we can all do, even.
Even when the waters rise and the waves are crashing over, we're hard pressed on every side but won't give up the fight. Surely you are holding on, even when the waters rise and the waves are crashing over. To see suffering and pain and still to say,